You really need to have a bit of an analytical brain to go into policymaking. You can't exactly ignore the statistic. It's the same as if you're in an internet battle and you're trying to go, here's the statistic. It's 59% of people believe this. They might go, you're an idiot, fascist. It's like, okay, well, now I know that you probably agree with my point and you have nothing to say to it. So go ahead, call me a fascist again. I don't care. You just lost, you know?
Hi, Cooper. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Yeah, Artie, thanks for having me. This is a really cool invitation, and I'm honored to be here.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, you're a co-host of the Elevated Thoughts podcast, and you're an elevator professional. For any listeners that might not be familiar with you, anything else you'd want to share?
No, I don't have a history in politics. Don't have a history in history or anything like that. Went to college for marketing, and I got into the elevator trade. Not working with my hands, but I was the office guy. So I've been a sales rep in that world in Manhattan for many years, which is a great place to work on elevators. A lot of tall buildings there. But yeah, it's weird. The elevator world is not something that people know about. In fact, I certainly didn't. I ran into them at a career fair almost by accident and took the job literally right out of college before I even graduated. And I'm still there, right? 10 or 12 years later. And it's been a really great thing. I suggest everybody look into the elevator trade because it is fruitful, not only for the guys that work on the elevators and work in the field, but it's a really good job where I get treated really well. I have a lot of freedom and I do pretty well for myself. Even now where I'm in Connecticut, outside of New York, it's a little bit slower, but it's still been a pretty good business. So yeah, I work. That's where I got the name Elevator Charles. It was shout out the Punch Bowl. They're a Twitter space that runs every morning. They were kind of like, elevator's so cool. You know, nobody knows about that. And so they go, you should call yourself Elevator Charles. And you introduced me as Cooper, which is definitely my name and what I go by. But if anyone's confused, my name is Charles Cooper Simmons. So my dad's name is Charles as well, but I go by the middle name, Cooper.
Yeah. So the name of the podcast is Elevated Thoughts. Is that like because of the elevator work too?
In a way, yes, but okay. We definitely don't talk about elevators on the show. Yeah, yeah. In fact, my co-host, Mike, who we did, I started the podcast for myself, and that's why I called it Elevated, Elevator, all this stuff. Yeah. But really, it didn't go anywhere. It was just me reading news headlines a couple days. And that's when I asked Mike to come on. And I've been on Twitter for four maybe more years now, kind of trying to get out there and get my voice heard and tweet some of the stuff that's important to me, because it was around that time that January 6th happened. Trump had lost the election, or so we thought, or so we didn't think, depending on who you are or what news you were reading. And that's why after going down this, I don't want to speak badly about anyone on the right. I am on the right. I'm a Republican proudly, I guess, but I've loosened my stance already. And that's why I decided, okay, let me reach out to Mike, who one of my closest friends. We went to college together. We, you know, didn't live together, but lived across the street from each other for so many years. Now he's down in Florida with his wife, but he's a very staunch Democrat and a really smart guy, well-read, well-spoken. And I decided, you know what, it's time to bring on somebody else. You probably know better than anyone what a grind it is to do a one-man show from start to finish, interviewing all of that. It's not easy. So it's been a great motivator, but also it's been a great way to learn and not only learn about the topics we talk about, which is primarily politics and history and some cultural things that go on, you know, like some conspiracies and all that stuff.
Yeah.
But it's been an experience to learn how to communicate better with the other side, because that's been something that's lacking. Right. And that's really the mission of our show, Elevated Thoughts, is to work together to find common ground, definitely disagree, definitely even argue at times, but more so stay calm, stay friends, right? That's what you see a lot is people lose their friends, lose their family over their political slant. And as my friend Dustin said, it's not worth losing your family or your friends over a quarter point interest rate policy. You know, that's really not going to do it. So it's been great. ElevatedThoughtsPod.com. I'm already plugging it too soon, but we've had a lot of fun, and we're on episode 37 now. So this week when we come out with another one, will be episode 38. And I wanted to tell you, actually, Artie, I'm going to shut up in a second. We were reading a statistic. You get into the top 1% of podcasters after you cross to episode 26. So 99% of podcasts fail after episode 25. So us and you, we're in there. We're in the top 1% there now.
Yeah. I was one of those ones that failed before 26 because I – in 2020, I started the podcast originally, only went for about 10 episodes. Everything else got in the way and I closed up. And last year I was like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to stick it through, not give up. And it's been a ride. So you're at 37 episodes. What episode did Mike start with you?
Episode one, to be honest. We just restarted the count.
Okay. Gotcha.
When I first started, I was, news has always been my reading material, whether you call it news or not, I don't know, but I do read a lot of news and I watch news, but I scroll the Twitter feed, and I still call it Twitter from the old days, even though I'm on Elon's team here. But I like reading that stuff. So that was kind of, as I was going, I said, hey, I'm spending a lot of time on social media. I want to take my knowledge, culminate it and put it out there. And that's what I would do. I would bookmark things every day. And I tried to do a daily thing. But way too much work, way too much, seriously, especially balancing a wife that I have and the house. And now we have a baby, just a year and 1 month old.
Nice.
And a full-time job and the podcast. Yeah. Oh my God, my head starts spinning. So yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot to juggle. You guys release weekly, right?
Yes. Every Wednesday we try, and we've stuck to it. It's been pretty, that's one of the biggest things. In fact, when we were trying to figure out, okay, what's next? What do we do? How do we grow this? One thing that we really resonated with us as we were watching these YouTube videos, what to do next, what to do. Someone said, don't set a goal of, get 10,000 subscribers or get 1 million likes or views. Set a goal that you have control over, right? Set a goal of a video a week. Set a goal of a post or a thread every day or something like that. And that's been what's making it manageable. Having that consistency, I think, is what's kind of led to a little bit of what we see as our successes. We're by no means successful. It's been interesting to look at the metrics and say, our chart is actually going in the right direction. So that's a really cool thing to witness from behind the scenes as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. You always have these goals, these lofty goals of like, I want to be big, I want to get sponsored, all this kind of stuff. But it's like, it takes time and it distracts from the mission of just creating and having good conversations for the most part. I definitely want to get into your relationship with Mike and how that works with that dynamic and everything like that. And the news, there's so much I want to get into, but I think the most important question, well, first of all, we're recording this on the 11th. It's going to be released on the 21st. So a little bit of a delay for any listeners. If we're talking about anything that just sounds a little out of date by then, things move fast with politics, all that. But Trump won the election. So the little handmade tail dresses and outfits, are those going to be issued by the federal government, or is that going to be something everyone has to buy for themselves?
It's a great question, and it's a shame they just packed up all the Spirit Halloween shops, because they would have been very good distribution network. Listen, man, it's a great question, and it's so funny you say that. It's been the meme of the week, and I bet you it will still be the meme of the week when we go post this video. But I think this whole situation is kind of wild. Obviously, these are the conversations that you have as a political commentator online all the time throughout the election season. And, that's my opinion, is this is exactly the reason pinpointed as to why Kamala lost the election, the abortion issue. I just can't believe that, I live in Connecticut. It's very deep blue in the Northeast here. All around us is blue. It's very hard pressed to find even a Trump sign in many places. But of course, when you go to the polls, it's a little bit closer than you might expect. But they talked about abortion so much. And everybody I talked about in real life, that seemed to be the number one thing. They'd say, you're a racist, you're sexist, and you want to take women's bodily autonomy away from them. And I hear this kind of thing, and it really irks me a bit, because I'm none of those things, obviously, or hopefully it's obvious. If you watch my show, you'd know. But beyond that, I don't even think that the plan is to take abortion away or make abortion legal. And guess what, guys? In Connecticut, I could go tomorrow, I could buy 1 million abortions, 100,000 abortions today, right? This is allowed. So why would the people that I'm dealing with here and talking to in Connecticut here, why do they want to say over what people in Texas are doing? I think I understand the empathy part of it, but it also is kind of highlighting that authoritarianness that a lot of Republicans blame Democrats of having, to say, you guys want this control, you guys want to have it your way. And at the same time, none of the other stuff or the other side, right? We're going to ban all of that, block all of that, shut you up and censor you and cancel you. But at the same time, we're going to make you get the vaccine and all of that. And this is the time where I probably should say, yes, I am vaccinated. I lived in New York City when this the shot came out. I couldn't even go to the movie theater or go out to brunch with my family when they visited if I didn't get the shot.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that this show has done is like I said, just really moderated my opinions. Where I used to be really hardcore arguing with friends and family, now I take the time to listen, absorb. If I don't know it, I say, I don't know the information. But if I do, I can obviously go back and forth with somebody. So no, they're not going to send handmaidens dresses. And I do think Project 2025 is going to be implemented to some degree. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know if people on the left like to hear that, but I do think it's going to happen. And they know it. Matt Walsh put out a joke. I want to talk about this because last week I started our episode by wearing my MAGA hat and saying, you know, well, guys, I guess the election's over, so we could tell you Project 2025 is the plan. We actually like the plan. We're going to follow it. We're going to deport everyone. We're going to send everybody. Every abortion is going to be canceled, you know. And that was a Matt Walsh joke, the obviously the am I a woman, am I racist kind of Daily Wire guy. But the joke was, the left has been lying to you. If you watch Rachel Maddow or Joy Reid for one afternoon, you're going to hear how sick they are about Project 2025, Trump's plan, and how it bans abortion. Well, they're lying to you. They're lying saying that that's Trump's plan. They're lying saying that it bans abortion. Those are two untrue statements. So it's funny to me when I go on the show or when Matt says it on very publicly, he's a lot more followers. We're going to follow the plan, right? Well, he's doing the same thing that they've been doing to you guys on the left for a long, long time. They're lying to you and we're lying to you now. So it's once you can break out of that echo chamber, I think you kind of open your eyes. Now, with that said, it's a 900-page document. It definitely isn't going to encourage more abortions, but it definitely isn't going to end abortions in this state or California or New York. Pretty sure you're going to be able to go get those if you want them. And hey, everybody has their own opinions. Don't get it if you don't want it. Get it if you want it. That's honestly how I feel about it. And that's unpopular among the right.
Well, Trump distanced himself from Project 2025 a bit, or he tried to. But you're saying that it's going to be implemented. So is this just a happen chance overlap of his plan and 2025 or Project 2025? Or is it like actual collaboration with what institute? Is it the Hoover Institute that came out with that?
No, I don't think it's the Hoover Institute, but I would be guessing if I told you, but,
it was a conservative think tank.
Though. Exactly. Yeah. But I know that it was orchestrated by Stephen Miller. Honestly, I don't know the authors of it as well as I know what's in the content of it, because that was when they were saying, oh, this is terrible. This is X, Y, and Z is going to happen. And I said, well, I don't, where does it say that? You know, point to me in page out of 650, where does it say that? And there's a whole thing about the Department of Health and Services, how they're going to revamp it. And sure, are we going to take away Medicare, Medicaid-funded abortions? That's what the plan calls for. I think the answer is, yeah, what you said. There's a little bit more overlap. But also at the same time, I think you're seeing the people that he's been appointing lately were also involved with drafting it, like Stephen Miller, for example, who was his some sort of advisor, you know, economic advisor back in his first term. He had made a major part of that. But yeah, beyond even distancing himself, Trump did from Project 2025, he came right out and said, I believe it was his words. It could have been Vance that said it, but I believe it was Trump who said himself, if they put a bill that nationally or federally bans abortion, Trump is going to veto it.
Yeah.
How more clear can that be?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I don't. I think Trump for a Republican is fairly liberal. Like. And this is the weird thing about him, you know, the demonization of Trump is like he's called Hitler, he's called a fascist and all these horrible things. And it kind of gets tiring. And first of all, I'm wondering, how do you handle or do you even have conversations outside of the podcast and like Twitter and stuff like that or X? Do you have these conversations with people who are normies? I don't like using that word, but people who are not actively involved in politics and reading the news all the time. Because I feel like, and this is not just one side or the other, but there tends to be a lot of low information voters and people who are just engaged for like a month prior to the election and then they're off. But, you know, people will say Trump is going to be a dictator. He's a fascist. He's never going to leave office. All of this kind of stuff that's just hyperbole and just not even grounded in reality. Like, I know he claimed the election results were fraudulent and there were legal issues with that anyway. There were problems. You don't even have to get into the fraud to see what's wrong with 2020. But he left office at the end. And like, you can say there was that riot on January 6th, but still, he left office. He didn't, you know, try to use the military or anything like that. And he actually called for National Guard for January 6th, which got denied.
Yeah.
So like, do you have conversations with people who are just not very well informed, or do you just kind of avoid that and leave it to people that are in the know at this point?
It's a great question. And I don't shy away from conversations. I mean, that's my MO as a person. Like, I am a very direct person. If I have an opinion on something and they just look my way, I'll be happy to share it. And it gets me in trouble, honestly. But the podcast has been an outlet to not have to talk about it as much. And I saw X as that for many years leading up to it, or Twitter. I already said I'd call it Twitter, so I'll stick consistency. But using that has been my outlet primarily. But I do know the people that are on limits, I'll say, in my real life. And, you know, I'm lucky to have a big network of friends. I went to college locally. I'm near the town I grew up. So I have a lot of people that know me as, hey, he's the political guy. Let's talk to him about this or that. And I'll say this, actually. I find that I have more enjoyable conversations talking to people that are Democrats or that are on the left. Find that when I talk to people who are on the right or Republicans, it really strays very quickly into some of the more hyperbolic. Whereas I do believe, and maybe it's just the nature of they're more calm when they're talking to me as a Democrat, or they're more informed, and that's maybe why they feel ready to talk to me about it. But they always seem to have a little bit of a handle on some specifics, right? Yeah. Whereas people on the right will tell you, oh, Rudy Giuliani told me there was suitcases of ballots, you know, in a water leak that didn't happen. And it's like, because when you say that, that's not what you should be focused on. You should be focused on the voter rolls, or you should be focused on the court cases that didn't get heard, or the executive orders or the Supreme Court rulings that were not legal because they weren't legislated that way. You know, that's the kind of thing that we need to take the time to look at, but that doesn't get the clicks. And that's why when you said low information voters, it couldn't be more true. Not only are they low information, but they become single issue voters. And they don't realize, for example, if somebody was really concerned about Ukraine, they may decide that they're going to vote for, vote for Kamala Harris because they support Ukraine and they think she's going to be tougher on Russia. But also, you're getting the package deal of all the other stuff. You've forgotten all about our domestic issues. Mike and I saw it's a statistic. It was published in Foreign Affairs, I believe. 40% of American voters this cycle chose to look at foreign policy as their number one issue. 40%. Yeah. That's really significant. So it was like, how do you ignore the border? How do you ignore the economy? And here's what I would also say, just to caveat my own statement. I think that there's a great, robust system of checks and balances. And I don't know that the president directly impacts the status of a foreign war. I don't know if they directly impact this gas price or eggs pricing. You know, they say they're going to repeal the infrastructure or the inflation reduction infrastructure bill, but I bet you they won't. They're going to definitely go and build that Taiwan semiconductor manufacturing foundry here in the United States for $2 billion. Like, all these things are set in motion. They're not going to change. Yeah. So when I talk to people, I try to gauge what their media diet is before I even go into it. I know for a fact there are many people in my life that can't talk about it, and I choose not to. You know, I've learned that the hard way. But if you're on X, or if you're on Twitter, or if you're like listening to a podcast like this, I think that you're probably in the top 5, maybe top 10% of people who have information to back up what they're saying. If you're not taking the time and you're repeating the platitudes that you see on TV, and you're going to get in trouble when you go into a real conversation, because you're just not going to be able to keep up. And I do find that happens a lot. And I stop. I do. I try to keep it civil in real life.
Yeah. It's hard. I want to have those conversations. I mean, like, I like to help people see what's true and what's not, as much as I can, like as much as I know the truth, which I don't think I have all the facts or anything like that. I think I'm learning just as much as anybody else is, but it's, you know, I, on my personal Instagram account, that's probably where I'm connected to most of my friends prior to the podcast or anything like that. You know, I logged in the day after the election and I saw a lot of just, if you voted for this, unfriend me or all this kind of stuff. And I don't really post politics on that account, but I had to. I was like, because the way I see it, and I'm not a Republican. I did vote pragmatically for Trump in this election. But in 2016, I shared a picture of Trump. It was like a picture of Trump and it was like a Nazi thing. Like it was like him, Hitler. Like, so I'm the person that I'm criticizing.
You and J.D. Vance.
Yeah. Like I saw him as an evil person and I still think he has tons of flaws and things to be concerned about. But I think our checks and balances work pretty well. And I don't know. I saw all this stuff and I'm just thinking, I'm like, okay, in 2020, when the Democrats won, I saw these people demonize the people who lost. And now it's 2024 and they lost and they're doing the same damn thing. They're just demonizing people that think differently than them. And I'm like, if you guys think 75 million people are just racist, not all of whom are white, I mean, it doesn't make sense to me. Like I can't remember who it was, but I saw somebody put out a post and it said, nobody voted against your rights. They voted against the delusion that your rights were on the line.
Yeah. I saw that exact clip. Yeah.
That's pretty good. I like that. So
yeah. Well, what you said of informing people, it is important, but it's so difficult and it's so delicate, you know, because if you don't validate a person when you're in conversation with them and say, I understand why you think that, I understand why you're saying that, I completely empathize, you know, then the person's just going to shut down. That's just, you know, honestly, that's a salesman in me talking about how do I talk to a person? How do I get them on my team before I even know them Oh, I'm listening to you. I'm giving you this emotional validation. And then maybe I can begin to share with you the actual facts that I have kind of logged in the back of my brain here. Hey, an unwarranted opinion is definitely, or an unasked for opinion is usually met with a little bit of contention. And even still, if you go slow, people just don't like to change their mind. That's been like the number one change that I think I've adopted is if you talk to me in 2022, I would have told you exactly what I just dispelled before, is that Rudy Giuliani said there were suitcases of ballots and they were pushed around things. And Ruby Freeman, the woman, you know, who was counting those ballots in Georgia, she should have been in jail. And Carrie Lake won and they're rigging the elections in Arizona. And I could have told you every detail. I have articles written about it on my Substack. And today, it's funny because I could read those and I say, yeah, I agree with everything I said. You know, Arizona collects their... They do mail-in balloting, and they recently made it universal, but that means that everybody gets a ballot. But now if you don't mail in your ballot on time, it might not make it in time. So they created same-day mail-in drop-off ballots. Mm. So it's like, oh, my God. You'd think if you're going to drop off a mail-in ballot on the same day, you would just vote in person. But no. Yeah. So by 8 p.m. on election day, they go to all these drop boxes and pick up the final remainders. They then take all of these ballots, which are sealed in envelopes. And in Arizona, you actually have to sign the outside of the envelope where it seals so they can show it's not broken. And all of those ballots get shipped to the main processing center. And then what happens is they actually get counted quickly, where they actually say it's an estimate done by weight. And that's important because then they're transported to Runbeck Election Services. And they're kind of similar to a Dominion. They create tabulators, they create scanners, they create election systems. And the gentleman Runbeck, when you look into him and his wife, they're multi-million dollars to Act Blue, the largest political action committee for the Democrats. So what happens is they give them these boxes of ballots. In this case, I think it was close to 300,000 ballots. And they then open the envelopes with Runbeck employees who are not state election workers. They open all the envelopes, scan the envelopes, and verify the signatures using their own proprietary equipment at Runbeck. And then they take the ballots and flatten them out, and then they deliver them back to the Central Processing Count Center, where they actually have the election workers to go and count and tabulate the ballots. So in 2022, it was a midterm election. I think Carrie Lake was running for governor against Katie Hobbs. And there was an issue with the chain of custody documents. There were 300,000 ballots that did not have chain of custody in. And there was a news report that said it was 325,000, for example. And then when the actual number came out, when they returned the ballots, it was slightly higher by about 15 or 20,000 ballots. And the elections administration said, oh, no. This was just an estimate. It was not the real count. You know, we just weigh. We don't count the actual things. And then on the way back, they count them. So that's like an example of, wait a minute. You're taking our ballots somewhere else with a certain count, and then they're opening them, they're moving them, they're shuffling them, and then we get them back over here and they're counting them. So right now, I agree with everything I just said. It's all accurate, you know? But at the same time, they recounted and recounted and recounted, and they presumably checked the rolls. So the count is accurate, right? But now what do we do with that information? We're circling in this, every state, all the 5-7 swing states, you could tell these same stories, right? You could even find people online that say Michigan has been proven to be fraudulent in 2020. In fact, the Michigan Secretary of State even wrote a letter saying as much. Okay. Where is the detail? Where is the background? It's impossible. It is truly impossible for a layman like us, even someone who researches it and reads it virtually every day. It's impossible for us to know the truth. So I don't know where I fall on that. I don't even remember your question, but I don't know if I believe it or not, right? Isn't that such a tough place to be in?
Yeah, it is. It's very difficult. I mean, the 2020 stuff, I still feel like there's some iffy stuff that went on. Like, while I haven't been doing a podcast my whole life or anything like that, I have been pretty engaged with politics for my whole life at different times more than others. And you know, in 2016, I liked Bernie, so I started paying attention again. Yeah. And I don't know, I just, every election I've ever watched, presidential election, other than the one with Gore and Bush, like we knew who the winner was that night.
Yeah.
Like, you know, maybe it's after midnight on the East Coast, whatever it might be. But we know the winner that night. And then in 2020, it was like, oh, we're not going to know the winner that night. It's like, okay. But I remember I stayed up really late and it's like, oh, this is done. Trump won. Like, there's no way Biden wins at this point. And then, you know, I go to bed and then I wake up and it's like five states shifted. I think it was five states shifted from red to blue. And it's like, wait, what? This doesn't make any sense. And it's like, you know, you see these clips of, you know, little things that are going on TV that people record. And then you see the number of votes in one state, I think it was Michigan, where they just jump up. They're 100% for Biden. But you don't even have to get into fraud. Like, you can get into Mark Zuckerberg pouring $400 million into Democrat strongholds, which is illegal. You have to have, if you're going to put any money into elections, it has to be basically nonpartisan. It can't favor one party or the other. And then you had the legislature in places like Pennsylvania, the judicial branch in Pennsylvania changed the requirements for mail-in ballots. Like, they allowed mail-in ballots that weren't allowed before, and they just overrode the legislature. They just took their authority.
Yeah.
They robbed them of their authority. And they said, no, we're just going to make this law.
You're 100% right.
And it's kind of crazy to see that stuff. And it's like, one of the crazy things to watch is, like, even, I mean, there were a ton of cases. A lot of them didn't even get heard because of lack of standing. And then even when something does get, like, okay, yeah, there was something fishy, what do you do about it? You're 2-3 years into someone's term by that point. Like, had they found like, the smoking gun and been like, okay, there was definitely fraud. Biden shouldn't have won. When he's 3 years into his term, what are they going to do at that point? You know?
Well, that's a testament to robust checks and balances, right? We have the Electoral College, where the actual vote count doesn't even matter. They just give you points, essentially. And the truth is, right, that he was certified. Mike Pence on January 6th, it was technically the 7th at that time, he made it official. I don't think you could have. I think by January 7th and 8th, if there was, you know, it blew up and oh my God, Brad Raffensperger, he all of a sudden found 12,000 ballots. Truly, I don't think it would have changed it. I think that too bad, right? That's what they would have said. Honestly, I don't know. I don't know, but.
Yeah. I heard you talking about this on your podcast, the we only need to find 12,000 votes. That phone call with Raffensperger, was Trump asking for Raffensperger to switch votes from Biden to Trump?
Yeah, so no, it was not, in my opinion. I mean, obviously, this is probably going to wind up in some sort of court case if Jack Smith doesn't withdraw, but looks like he might be. And I think he's the one that covers the elector scheme. I'm by no means an expert in all of the cases brought against Trump. I try to avoid those. But the Raffensperger call is really interesting to me. And my opinion of it is definitely different than what the mainstream media is. I consider this call another hoax, similar to that of saying that he called all service members suckers and losers, right? It's just something that is totally twisted out of context. I think when you listen to that full call, and I encourage everyone to go listen to not just 1 minute of it, but listen to like, I think it's only like 10 minutes or less, but you'll find that Trump is describing within the very call multiple different avenues of which fraud could have been discovered, right? And it's now 4 years ago, so forgive me, but there was, for example, dead voters that could have been over 12,000 votes. There could have been out-of-state voters that they feel were over 12,000 votes. They could have brought up this, the poll watchers were sent home, right? That's the way that you would better describe the Rudy Giuliani claims, is there was this water leak and it happened in the morning and it stopped counting and it pushed things later. And all of the poll watchers around 10 o'clock were sent home. And that's when you see videos of people rescanning and rescanning and rescanning. And wait a minute, why is nobody here? There's four people in the room. So I don't know. They recounted. But anyway, Raffensperger was asked, hey, you're in charge of the election. You're the Secretary of State. So you can decide. You can decide what ballots you want to expose as fraudulent to change the result of the election. Or if you want to say, you know, oh, well, we've cleaned up our rolls and actually we realized, you know, there was a 15,000 vote discrepancy here. In election integrity, the word they use is injecting ballots into the ballot supply. So it's very rare. And like you're saying, we don't have to get to the fraud component of it. Yeah. But that's what they're claiming. He said, find me 11,500. And that's not what he was saying. He was saying, you decide what's best for you, Brad. What's the least damaging for you? What's the least damaging to your people and the story and the narrative that you guys want to tell and the media firestorm that will definitely happen? But be brave, pick one of these examples and show us how we're going to find 12,000 ballots to make this election fair.
Yeah.
Again, that's not my opinion. That's of what Trump is claiming in that call. That's my interpretation of the reading of what Trump's intention was. I'm the first to admit Trump has like great comedic delivery, but he is not very statesmanly. And he definitely shoots from the hip when it comes to reading from a prompter. He does not stick to the script. So you're going to get yourself in trouble sometimes, right? And he did the same thing with Victor Lindemann, right, on the Ukraine call. Got an impeachment over this, saying it's a quid pro quo. But meanwhile, you know, you could point to dozens of examples that are far more obscene than that by the Biden administration alone, frankly.
Yeah, it's one thing I do think it's different than the suckers and losers because – and maybe correct me if I'm wrong, but the suckers and losers, there's no verification that that ever happened. So that could very well be just completely made up, not even just a twisting, but a complete fabrication.
Even better. But, yeah, you're correct. You are.
But with the Raffensperger call, you brought up, what was the other thing you brought up? The Ukraine call, right? There's this trend when it comes to Trump. And this is one of the things that I think the Democrats or the left or whoever hates Trump, it's one of their big blind spots is they, and I've said this before, like one of the biggest dangers with Trump is not necessarily what Trump will do. It's what the hate for him will cause people to do. Because I've always been like, okay, if you don't want one side to start doing things and crossing that Rubicon and doing things that the other side isn't doing, because then you just have an escalation. The other side's going to do it when they get into power, or you end up with a one-party state because one party just takes control. But I've seen people cross their moral lines, or what I would imagine are their moral lines, so many times. And like the lies that they, I talked to Adam B. Coleman, and he said this. He's like, if you didn't have to make up lies about Hitler, like you just give the truth about Hitler. But with Trump, for some reason, they think he's so bad that they have to make up stuff about him to prove how bad he is. And it's like, yeah. That doesn't work. Like most people can see through that, I think. And that's part of the reason Trump won.
I think you're right. I mean, there's always been this saying when they go, oh, he's an idiot. He's a moron. You're going to give him the launch codes, the nukes. It's like, wait a minute. Is he this mastermind who's trying to pull the strings and, you know, affect these policies that are crazy and out there and close the border or whatever it is? You know, is he a bumbling idiot, or is he actually really smart and he's going to be able to make a million plus deportations? Or is he just going to try to force everyone to do it and fire them if they don't? You know, yeah. I think that you can't really have it both ways. You have to give him the credit, or else it's the same thing in talking about these election conspiracies. If you're going to go off the deep end and just totally sully your credibility, then it's really tough to have a real conversation. And it, you know what the good thing about that, though? It shows and exposes that person early on in a conversation. It's the same as if you're in an internet battle and you're trying to go, here's the statistic. It's 59% of people believe this. They might go, you're an idiot, fascist. It's like, okay, well, now I know that you probably agree with my point and you have nothing to say to it. So yeah. Go ahead. Call me a fascist again. I don't care. You just lost, you know?
Yeah.
It's just, you can't have it both ways. You really cannot. And that's... they're lying to themselves. It's you have to be intellectually honest with yourself, right? If you're going to, I don't know. Do you think, Artie, that when somebody like, you know, not to name names, but my mom watches MSNBC at nighttime and Rachel Maddow is going the Russia hoax for like last 8 years, do you think that those viewers know that it's very like scanty truths? Or do you think that they're bought in and they say, well, because Manafort was involved, like that means Trump was involved. Like this was real. You know, the Internet Research Agency, they spun the conservatives up online. It's like, guys, they had like 100 accounts. They got like 1.5 million impressions. I had one tweet last week that did that one. I'm not famous. It's like, how can you try to follow that course? But then in the back of your head, you know, this is kind of BS. It's kind of BS. Yeah. And I really feel that a good portion of people that feel that way, they know. Yeah. And they're just letting it live in their own heads.
Well, there is a tendency for humans to want to hear what they already believe. We don't want our beliefs challenged for the most part. I think people like us that are having these conversations, a lot of the people we interact with on places like X, there are a different breed of people that want to have meaningful conversations and aren't worried about being right or anything like that. Most people they just want to feel validated. They want to validate their opinions. So if you believe Trump is a monster, if you believe that Russia stole the 2016 election and now elections are more secure than ever, but maybe not anymore because Trump won or whatever it might be, I think MSNBC is where you go to validate essentially crazy opinions. Like I don't know many people who watch MSNBC, but I know a few people, and most of them are not people who understand politics very well. And they don't understand the objective reality of the situations. It's just, I mean, I can go on about how horrible corporate media is all day, but MSNBC is like they're in a league of their own with the delusional takes that they have.
What's interesting too is they have this air of superiority, of moral superiority, and they're driven to feel this way due to their empathetic nature, right? That if you are someone that works for MSNBC or you're someone that watches them, you're saying, we need to protect these migrants. They're coming to a better life, or these women are dying in Louisiana every day because they're being refused necessary care, but for the life of the baby. It's like, guys, you're concerning yourself with this one emotional aspect. And I said before, like, I'm a very direct person. I'll just tell you my feelings. It might hurt your feelings. I honestly can't even tell probably, but anyway, they care about the feelings. You really need to have a bit of an analytical brain to go into policymaking. You can't exactly ignore the statistic. I loved watching Matt Walsh's movie. I didn't love it as much as What Is a Woman, but I liked watching Am I Racist? And there was one guy in there. I'm kind of kicking myself for not remembering his name, but he wrote the book Hate Crime Hoax. And it was my favorite interview in the movie because he said he was asked a question by liberal version of Matt Walsh, the DEI expert in disguise. And he said, you know, don't you think hate crimes are a massive problem? There were 7,500 hate crimes last year. And the guy goes, yeah, no, that doesn't matter. That's not even registering on the statistics. There was like 200 million crimes. You know, you're talking about 7,000, yeah. Right? So it was like, we're choosing to focus in on this tiny little narrow of a pinhead data point. You know, we should eradicate all great white sharks because, dude, there was one attack a year ago, okay, in the Connecticut Long Island Sound. We need to get rid of all the white great white sharks in the whole world, okay?
Yeah.
It's like, no, this doesn't add up. So when you're emotional and you know, that's probably what it is. They want to care for people, and that's a good thing. It really is. But you're not recognizing, if you're feeling that way, that you're disregarding a lot of the other people. And to your point as well, it was they just contradict themselves then by getting out of hand, frankly. And I hate myself. I'm about to even say this, but it's both sides, you know. The both sides game is so terrible. It's funny. I said I was talking with Mike, and I was like, well, my podcast partner, and I was like, you know, they boarded up all of the walls or all of the windows in New York City in 2020 for that election, waiting for the results, right? And yeah. Nothing happened. He goes, yeah, it didn't happen, right? Until January 6th. I'm like, oh, well, okay, you're right. We did riot. I forgot we rioted.
Nah. You know,
because you look at Minneapolis. But it's like, all right, it's both sides. Just don't cross that Rubicon. I love that you said it. And you have to. You have to stay respectful. Even this podcast, like right now, the conversation that we had, I bet you someone would say, oh, they've already crossed the line. They've already lost me. You know, They said Project 2025 isn't that bad. You know, it's tough. I'd say right now, so far, we've been pretty pragmatic, I think.
Yeah. You know, you mentioned something. You mentioned moral superiority. And I feel like that's what I saw some acquaintances or friends posting on Instagram. And that's what I felt. Moral superiority. I believe I'm right, so I'm better than you because I believe I'm right. That's the extent of that logic, in my opinion. And it's kind of wild. And I don't know. I don't know what to do about that. Because I think, you know, liberals tend to be more emotional. And I'm actually like center left. I used to be very liberal, you know, way more progressive. But I've had to learn how to separate my emotion from those arguments sometimes. And I feel like I can ground my arguments and make them better. I don't often get into I do get into details and stuff like that, but I'm more theoretical. So if anything is like theory, I can just work through it theoretically without necessarily needing all the details. But it's strange to me looking back, and it's like, have I changed so much? Have I changed so much that I can no longer identify with people that are where I used to be 8 years ago? And that's something I've been struggling with for a long time. I have tons of good conversations with liberal people, good conversation with people on the right, but I found myself, I used to believe Republicans were evil and just horrible, racist, all this kind of stuff. But I was in college. Those are the talking points that you get just pushed down your throat. And it's also kind of weird when you get into college and you start hearing professors talk about politics. I think that's kind of, I don't want to say wrong, but I think it should be done with care because college is really unique. Like when you're growing up, everyone's talking to you like a child, right? And then you get to college and you start having these professors who most of them are like just dismissive of you. But then you have a few that like treat you like an adult and you're like, oh, this person thinks of me as an equal. Like that, it's not even just they're a teacher, I'm a student. I'm treated like an adult with this person. Then they start to share their opinions and they're obviously well more informed than you and all this stuff. So I think it's really easy. We're really susceptible at that age, like 19 to or 18 to 24, whatever most people go to college around. I think we're really susceptible to that. But long story short, like I struggle figuring out if I've just changed so much that I can't identify with those people, or if there's just no logic there, so that if there's nothing to work with. I don't know.
It's an interesting thing that when you look at the complainers on the right, what they say is, oh, well, they're shifting the left. They're shifting the center further and further to the left. I'm probably reverse on my camera, but right. So if the center, though, is shifting to the left, you're not distributing the people. You're changing the goalpost. And actually, as you shift the center to the left, well, here you were. Now you're on the right, brother. Yeah. So I don't think that you changed. I think that society changed a bit. And hey, that's a good thing. You said before, how do we appeal to these emotional types? How do we get through the right information? I mean, listen, I lose followers because I write all the time. I write, Ray Epps wasn't a Fed, okay? Mm-hmm. This was a guy that just showed up and was concerned. I read every freaking 125-page transcript. I read everything I could. I've seen every video of him where they claim, oh, he's moving things. He's not, okay? The other one I was going to say was, it's coming away from me, man. But these examples of where it's like, oh, I would say, I don't mind if somebody wants to get an abortion in my state. I'm not very religious. I don't mind. You know, it's not really, why are we dying on the hill? You have to be able to find the common ground. And I love immigrants. I love people from other countries. I've traveled to many, many places around the world. I've made great friends in those countries. We've, you know, hung out with them again. And it's like, I love immigrants. Come to our country. Full stop.
Yeah.
Argue with me if you're a Democrat, right? But you're going to tell them they should huff a plastic bag on their back through the Rio Grande River? That's what you're going to suggest to that person? I would say, right, if we actually get into the weeds on that, probably feel pretty similarly, right? Yeah. My wife had our first child a year ago. She was pregnant for 9 months. And we knew that she was pregnant before she even missed her period. We knew, like, the tests are so good now. We knew within, I don't know, 2 weeks after conceiving.
Yeah.
And, but the reason I say that is as then you go through the first trimester, as you go through the next up to 6 months of being pregnant, at that point, if you don't know, or if you're not sure, or you know, it's like, hold on guys, can't we come to an agreement here that like, okay, 12, 14 weeks, maybe that's a good place to know. You're going to know you're pregnant by then. You're going to have an idea of what your life situation is, right? Isn't there a way to get this common ground? But no, instead we need to codify Roe, always legal no matter what, even in deep red Louisiana and Mississippi, or fully federally legal because we're the Christo-fascists. I can't even say it because it's such a ridiculous title, but like there's somewhere in the middle here, guys. Let's find that, right?
Well, I've had this conversation with my girlfriend. I tend to be pro-choice, like abortion. It bugs me if it's like late term, like if anyone's getting an abortion, I'm like, get it over with as fast as possible. Like for multiple reasons, like I think the ethical reasons are kind of arbitrary in a certain sense, because
agreed.
Yeah, one of the arguments is like, it's just a clump of cells. And it's like, actually I studied biology and it's a unique set of DNA. As soon as like the sperm and the egg come together, as soon as you have a zygote, I believe it's called, like it's you have, or embryo, I don't know.
I think you're right. Yeah, it's soon, not an embryo immediately.
Yeah. But it's a unique set of DNA. And it's just like they're talking points. Like I have a friend who's liberal and he was like, yeah, it's just a clump of cells. I'm like, well, that's a political argument you're making. That's not a scientific argument. I'm like, in so many other regards, you want to be scientific, but in this, you're willing to forego that and just be political. I've told my girlfriend when we were talking about this, and she disagreed, but she's also not that active in politics. I'm like, ending Roe v. Wade was the right decision. And the reason for that is there is no middle ground here. There is no, hey, this is the happy medium everyone's going to agree on, and this can be nationally the whole law. This covers all states. It can happen. I'm a fan of decentralization. Decentralize this. Give it to all 50 states. Have them decide. And yes, you're going to have some states that are more oppressive, restrictive, and don't allow it. You're going to have some states, like probably California, that it's going to be allowed at any point in the pregnancy. But if that's your issue, you can leave. Like, we can stay in the United States and go to a different state. That's one of the beautiful things about our country, isn't it?
Well, you and I are alike in that, you know, we probably in the Middle Ages wouldn't have been at the front lines as a warrior in battle, but we might have been in the village as the philosopher. That's how I kind of like to see myself in talking about these. But so the other side would say to you, though, well, why don't we leave slavery up to the states, right?
Yeah, I guess I can understand that. But
because they're saying, well, you want to segregate by one race, a minority of women in this case, and we're taking away their rights to have autonomy over their body.
Yeah.
And it's like, I guess I see it. You're right. You could go to a different state. I mean, you ever heard of the Underground Railroad? It's probably not the best example, right? But like, yeah, they were trying to get out of those states and they weren't always allowed to.
I can make an argument why they're not the same, though.
Okay.
I think a pretty good argument. In the case of slavery, all you had was a group of people being oppressed, a group of people being put into slavery. There is no cross-section of another potential right. With abortion, there are two rights that kind of intersect. There's the right to life and the right to medical decisions in your own life. So those two kind of intersect. There's nothing like that with slavery. There's just a completely lopsided predatory relationship between slaveholder and slave. And that's why it's unambiguously evil in that sense. With abortion, it's like, is it potentially murder to kill a fetus? Yeah, it is. Yeah. But is it also, are you also kind of restricting someone's rights to make their own medical decisions if you restrict their rights or their ability to get an abortion? Yeah, so there's that intersection. That's where I would draw the difference between those two.
Yeah, you're right. And that's where the very religious people are even, you know, we're saying it's a more scientific way of looking at it. I guess I do agree with that, right? That, yeah, you have a third party in the mix here who can't speak for themselves. So it's definitely touchy. I've made a bet with one of my friends here at home to say that I don't think anything's changing. I don't think it's going to be federally outlawed and I don't think it's going to be federally mandated. So if there's no change, I'm going to win that one. And I think I'm going to be right because – even still with the Republican triad here, House, Congress, and the three, it's still not going to happen. It's just not. I know it. I know it's not.
Well, it would be massively unpopular because even many Republicans are pro-choice to some extent. Like, the media will try to make it seem like Republicans are anti-abortion and Democrats are pro-abortion. Like, and it's just as simple and black and white as that. But the reality is most people are somewhere in the middle of that spectrum. Most people are like, yeah, I'm pro-choice, but also like, I don't want to see something happening in the third trimester. That's a little messed up. Most people are like that. And most people are like, I'm pro-life, but I want to give people the option for at least some period of time because, you know, I just think it's right.
I see it honestly as, you know, the scientific level of whether this has a DNA and all of that, right? To me, it's even simpler. It's like, well, we take penicillin, we take this, you know, we do different other medications that we excise tumors. That's living, breathing in a lot of ways. I don't know. I don't want to argue for abortion, but it's definitely a tough one. I actually like an argument that Mike had made recently, and I'm going to steal his thunder a little bit. But one of our friends was saying, if you go trans, you know, you're changing your body and it's bad because you're going to regret it. And Mike said, well, I live in Miami. Do you know how many BBLs and injectable lips I see every day? They're chopping up their bodies. They're changing the way they look, the way they act, the way they're perceived. Yeah. Should that be outlawed? You know? And it was like, damn, kind of an interesting point. Of course, the distinction there would be children and the age of which it's done. But it's true. It's and actually, you could argue it the other way, right? I was saying before that the liberals here in Connecticut want to have a say over what's happening in Texas. Well, the conservatives want to say over what's happening to transgender's bodies, right? And to ban them from that. It is very it's touchy. It's very touchy, man. And actually, the worst part about all of it is that the politicians aren't here to solve problems. The politicians are here to make themselves famous, I feel like, in a lot of cases, especially when you go into the House of Representatives, which have like over 200, 250, I think. It's because guys like Mike Gates, you know, he held up the election. I was a big fan. He held up Speaker McCarthy from getting in there, and he said, you got to promise these seven things. And the most important one was no more omnibus bills, single issue bills only. And eventually they outed him because he was not following what he said. He didn't release the January 6th tapes, which, well, they've been out. Where is it? Where's all the stuff we were supposed to hear? Nothing. But then they kept voting on omnibus and continuing resolutions, and it was just a joke. So it was good that they got rid of him. But then, hey, Matt Gaetz, you made yourself celebrity for 2 days over this, and you followed through with it. But then you shut up. You shut up when the current speaker steps in here. You know, what's going on? And then we have the border bill. Oh, Langford's border bill, where it's a $100 billion border bill. And I think it's like $19 billion goes to the border. The rest of it goes to Ukraine, Israel, and the Red Sea. It's like, oh my God, we really called that a border bill?
You know, the border bill is an interesting one because in the Kamala Trump debate, right? Not the debate, but like in the overall debate that people are having between the two candidates, it was something that got brought up a lot. It did get brought up by Kamala Harris when she had her one contentious interview with the Fox News, Brett Baer.
Brett Baer, yeah.
And I was actually furious with her answer because it's like, when I see the bills going through in Congress, I see money laundering. That's what I view most bills as.
Yeah.
And her response to why did you nix 60 plus border bills or border executive orders? Her answer was, well, we proposed legislation in Congress. We proposed the border bill that Trump squashed. And I just think that's asinine because you're in the executive branch. Like this writing legislation isn't in your purview. That's not something you do in the executive branch. You can advocate for legislation, but you don't write the bills. So it kind of, what I interpreted from that is you ended a bunch of executive orders to make the problem worse, and then you advocated for a border bill that would maybe make it a little bit better from the point that you got it to. And it just, it doesn't make sense why that's an answer and why so many people talk about this. As soon as you start talking about the border, they say, if they're pro Kamala Harris, they say, well, why did Trump squash the border bill? It's like, why are we even at that point? Why aren't we going back to these executive orders that were in place that were obviously doing something? Stay in Mexico was a good policy. Like, we don't need to house these people while things are getting figured out if they can safely be somewhere else. It just doesn't make sense.
I fully agree with you. With that said, though, as we philosophize here, it is interesting, though, that you know, you and I, who maybe support Trump's executive order policies, they are exactly that, right? They are executive orders. Yeah. They're the same way that they may have changed the voting system in Michigan at the last minute through executive order. And all of a sudden, that was deemed not okay. So in a lot of ways, right, and actually even deeper, right, that was why Roe versus Wade was overturned. They said, well, this created legislation through a court hearing. It needed to go through the legislature to become a law. And these are examples of the way that governing has changed. In we don't respect those three branches. You've got a group of celebs or wannabes over in Congress, and then you've got the authoritarian in chief in the Oval Office who's putting out these executive orders, and every single administration is overlapping and changing and just basically altering exactly the opposite as to what it was supposed to be in many cases. One example, though, I like to rub in everybody's face because they all say on the left, tariffs are a tax on the people. Yeah, there's examples that you can share, hypotheticals where that's the case. But then why would Biden leave the two, I think it was automobiles and steel, he left the two most important key tariffs that Trump proposed. But no, the media has told us it's a talking point. It's a tax on the citizens. I mean, it's there's many ways to look at that. And I think if we returned to basic civics, you know, the legislature makes the laws, things would be a lot more comprehensive, but they don't agree, these people, and they don't choose to. And then actually, how about this one? The way that we were saying, oh, if you're on X, if you're on Twitter, or if you're even listening to podcasts, you're probably in the most politically engaged. I would say that if you're willing to run for office, which it's not in my cards right now for sure, many, many years, because I don't want to be an extremist. I don't want to be someone that is going to get the clicks and the attention like Marjorie Taylor Greene does by saying there's Jewish space lasers and that riles up another 500,000 voters. You know, I think if she approached it differently and said they were Italian satellites by Leonardo who were hacking into Dominion machines, maybe there's a little bit more validity to it, but that's another conspiracy from 2020. So I didn't say it, but,
well, it's a big problem, right? Nuance does not get you reach. Like, I try to be nuanced in here. I have my bias. I have my opinions. But, like, nuance isn't like, oh, man, I'm just aching to hear that nuanced podcast where, like, they have well-thought-out ideas and they explore different possibilities. And it's like, people do enjoy that. It's not the majority of people, though. Majority of people want that, like, overly opinionated. I have this opinion and I'm sticking to it and I'm going to double down when you say I'm wrong. I mean, Trump kind of does that. Like Trump has he has had many examples where it's like, oh, there was kind of bullshit in what he was saying and he just doubles down. Sometimes he ends up being more right than originally it seems, but it's just this. Yeah, it's weird. It's hard to break through the noise of like, just extreme noise with nuance. Nuance just doesn't get heard.
Well, you and me, we've seen it with our podcasts, right? Yeah. Why aren't we meteoric growth like the Charlie Kirk Show or Steven Crowder's program? And it's because we have to do it the old-fashioned way, slow and steady, with people that actually do want to listen. Yeah. We don't want these one-minute clips that got ultra-virality because, you know, Candace Owens called out Rabbi Shmuley. You know, that's going to get a lot of clicks. But is it always totally valid and authentic? I don't know. And to me, that's a stain on credibility when you're going to get out there. Now, with that said, there was a trend. I don't know if you saw the chart where Trump and Harris compared the or somebody compared their time on podcasts. And I think it was that Harris made, you know, I'm going to bungle the numbers, but she made like 4 or 5 appearances on podcasts. And Trump made, I think, like 14 or 16 appearances. Mm. You know, it was maybe 3 or 5 fold. And the amount of views he got was about 100 million compared to her 15 or 20 million. Yeah. And what that tells me, though, is that people are trending towards those nuanced conversations, at least when you can understand the bias. And I'm not going to tell you Joe Rogan pushed back on Trump. He definitely didn't. But at the same time, you get the time to explore those ideas. How much better is that than these stupid debates that we watch where they mute a microphone and, you know, you have J.D. Vance going, you're not supposed to fact check me. And you have Kamala Harris saying Trump wrote 2025. Like, guys, this is not productive. Cancel it. You wasted all of our nights in the whole country. Okay. And you sold barely any ads because you don't run them. Don't do it again. Let's not do it. Where's the election commission? Let's not do that.
I mean, Kamala Harris and Donald Trump are both very capable of talking around a question. Kamala hasn't gotten to the point where she's named it like Trump has, or he's named it the weave. But I agree. Joe Rogan didn't push back on Trump enough. I also, even though, you know, Rogan's the biggest podcaster on earth, I still feel like that would be a somewhat of an intimidating atmosphere. You're sitting there with like potentially the future president, former president. Like, it's a pretty big interview, probably one of his biggest he's done.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I'm liking that people are moving toward these nuanced conversations. I would like to see the day where a podcast hosts a debate, because the debate format is insane. And it's insane to me that these news organizations that we know we can't trust, we've known this for decades, and it's been even more obvious for the last decade. But we know we can't trust these organizations, but somehow we give them the debates. Like, they have complete control over them, and that's it. It doesn't make sense.
I'll tell you this. I was really interested in the Hamas attack. It actually happened on October
7th?
8th or 9th, because it was the day my son was born. No, October 7th. That was when my son was born on the 8th, and we were like, my wife and I, oh, you have to save the newspaper of the day that he's born. And it was like, Hamas attacked Israel yesterday. That wasn't really the one to save, so we did not do that. But I was really interested in, and I tried to learn as much as I could. We even had, Mike had a friend from Israel who had served in the IDF. We interviewed him and all of this. It was still really, like, confusing to me what was actually going on, right? I was unable to decide if I was on the side of Israel retaliating or if I was on the side of, hey, we need to help these Palestinians, not Hamas, obviously, but right, is this going to create an overreaction and a humanitarian issue? I care about humans. I'm not a bigoted Republican like everyone thinks. But so how did I actually learn the most about that situation? It was through listening to the Lex Fridman podcast, where he had three scholars. I don't remember who their names were. One of them was named Finkelstein, and they were debating Destiny. And Destiny took the Palestinian side. I actually don't even remember. That guy is he's been coined a debate pervert because he'll debate anyone on any side. But it was really interesting, right? Because at the very least, they got to say, no, but what about this? And then the other expert would say, no, but what about this? Oh, and the charter and this resolution overruled that. And you're reading a document from 1981. There's a new one in 2002. And it's that kind of conversation where you really say, oh, wow, I think I'm starting to understand this a little bit differently. Yeah. I really think. And then the next level would be taking that information, which I'm not able to do it, but then explain it to somebody else. I think once you reach that level of comprehension, then you're allowed to go, you know, kind of talk to other people and share your point of view on it. But, you know, that's kind of why those are topics we sort of try to avoid. They're definitely hard hitting. But then at the same time, dude, nothing's going to change, right? Where Trump is going to still give money to Ukraine, probably just as much as Harris was giving. And they're going to still support Israel no matter what. Like, it's just, it's a lot of hubbub. It's a lot of hubbub over not a lot. And again, I forget what your question was exactly, but it was...
Oh, no worries.
Yeah, it's tough to... Nobody wants to watch people agree. They want to watch people fight. Yeah. You know, you scroll your Twitter feed, you got fights and murders and decapitations, and that's what's getting the clicks. It's a little bit of a frightening world at times.
Yeah, well, I would love to talk to Destiny sometime, but I do worry about, like, can we have a civil conversation, or is he... Because I notice he, like, starts yelling almost right away in every conversation he has, where it's like, it's very defensive. And it's like, I don't see, maybe I will have to interrupt somebody at some point, but it's like, I have a long form podcast for a reason, because I've had a couple interviews where it's like, oh, I only have an hour, or I only want to do 30 minutes. I've done one 30 minute interview, and I just felt like it was lacking by the end. It was with a politician, libertarian running for president before their primary or whatever. But it just felt like it was lacking. It's like, I couldn't really, I'm just asking surface level questions. And then that's how, like, a longer podcast often is like, and Joe Rogan, same thing. It's like, you're just getting to know somebody for the first like 30 minutes. Then after that, you can start getting into some real questions, and it's like, okay, something good happens now. But 30 minutes, I just don't feel like I can do anything with it. But yeah, with Destiny, the reason I was saying that is I don't feel like letting somebody finish their thought is going to hurt my ability to formulate and articulate a strong rebuttal of their thought and idea. But it seems like that's like the atmosphere we have right now, where it's like, I can't let you finish your thought, because if I let you finish, somehow I lose. But it just... When I hear just people talking over each other, I'm like, I'm done. I can't listen to this crap. I don't know.
In the conversation, I weaved in a conspiracy about an Italian Leonardo satellite, right? And if I hadn't stopped to kind of go, oh, that's a joke, you know, it may have just lived on as, hey, I wove that into conversation. And that is kind of scary. And I guess I see why they have to do that when they're out for blood trying to win a debate. That's the other thing, is actually when we started Elevated Thoughts podcast, Mike and I, it was debate, debate, debate. If you look back at our earlier ones, the first couple thumbnails are us putting our fists up as a joke. And then we'd watch the episodes and it's like, well, we didn't debate because we decided consciously we weren't going to do that. We were going to try to find common ground, not like argue. But we then had to shift. But that's what we were saying before, is like, you know, people are not as interested in having agreeable people. So we've done a couple of interviews where we definitely disagree with the guest. In fact, Mike and I were on different sides of one of the guests that we interviewed named Ashton Forbes, who is, you know, I could label him, people label him a conspiracy theorist. I don't know that I do. He talks about the MH370 Malaysian flight that disappeared in 2014.
Yeah.
He came onto the social media scene about a year and a half ago where these videos kind of resurfaced and said, what really happened with this plane? And I think Netflix came out with a documentary and that's why it was a bigger deal. But we reached out to Ashton and he agreed to come on. And I kind of was like into it. I was like, ooh, this is going to get us a lot of clicks because Ashton's really controversial. He says, he's, you know, it's like this alien kind of thing. It's like this secret government technology. Actually, he says it's not aliens. So throughout that interview, we kind of both just had a good time, Mike and I, nodding along and letting him tell his story. And actually, throughout it, we said a couple times like, oh, I think that's a stretch, Ashton, you know, or oh, I might disagree with that. But that was it. And we kind of just let him have his thing and tell it. But the way that we kind of were able to digest it was the next week, we reached out, or actually someone reached out to us and said, hey, I'm like the other side of this conversation. Would you like to have me on? And we were like, sure, yeah. And we brought on a visual effects artist because his whole story is that these orbs were circling the plane and then it went into a portal and it disappeared. That's why we've never found the plane. And he's saying that it's proof that the government has anti-gravitational, you know, zero point energy, he calls it, where you don't need any input to make an output. And okay, it changes all of physics, right? It's definitely a big claim. But he tells such a good story. I would encourage anyone, go to my podcast and listen to that interview. Because you're going to go, oh my God, I can't believe this. This is true. Look at what he said. But then if you do that, watch the following episode. And this is the way that the long form comes into play as well. If you can't, or we chose not to even get a word in, but then we let the graphics artist come on and she goes, yeah, I've done music videos. I've worked for different studios. You know, actually she remained anonymous, but so we don't know exactly who it is. Her name was Krishley online, but she was good. She right on the screen share, right in our podcast shows, yeah, here's how you'd make the plane. Here's how you'd make the balls rotate. You know, here's how you have the portal. She even found stock images that were used in the video. So there's a portal and a little blurb of light that happens at the end. They go, yeah, here, look, here's a stock video image from 1991 and you overlay it and it's identical, you know? So it was really interesting to say, oh my God, that's like a nail in the coffin right there.
Yeah.
And then actually we had, Jeff Wise, the guy who was in the Netflix documentary, who actually searches for this plane for real, you know, and looks at the satellite data and looks at the different underwater radars. So it's like, that's one way of doing it. And that's actually how we've kind of liked doing our show, is we like people to share their opinion, get their one side of the story out and kind of nod along, don't really push back. And then we get the other side of the story on and nod along and don't really push back. So actually right now we're looking for another one. We have, we just had Flint Dibble on, an archaeologist
who was on
Joe really Rogan.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was really cool. I was enamored by this guy when he was on Joe Rogan. I was actually on vacation down in Florida and it was like a 5-hour episode. So I was like, eh, why not? Okay. So that was like, oh my God, I never knew Graham Hancock's theories per se. I never read his books, but I was always like, oh, he's like kind of into this ancient world stuff. Definitely cool. I wish someone would look into it, you know? And as soon as this guy Flint Dibble came on, he was wearing this oversized suit. He was wearing this Indiana Jones hat. He has this beard and ponytail. It was kind of like disheveled. I was like, oh my God, I don't know what I'm about to watch here, but this is going to be a problem for the guy. Joe Rogan and Graham are going to eat him up. And I was blown away. If you guys have not seen this, go, don't even watch my interview with Flint. Go watch the Joe Rogan interview from early 2024 in like April or something. The guy, unbelievably and systematically, just every single point that Graham could possibly bring up, he dismantled it and said, here's why, here's not, here's why. Here's the person who wrote the study that you quote, Graham, and why he says that you're not quoting it accurately and you're twisting it. And it was 3 to 5 hours of gorgeous brilliance. And many people right now are going to definitely be unfollowing me and leaving hate critics because they don't like that. They like Graham Hancock's theory of Atlantis. And anyway, we had Flint on. And ever since then, there's been like a outpouring of support on one side and then total, why would you platform this liar, this heathen? You have to get him fired. And it's been cool in both of those cases, the flight and now this archaeology debate, to kind of just, hey, I'm a podcast host. I'm just talking to people. You know, I didn't make any decisions here. I didn't claim anything. But that's how we approach that nuanced conversation, is to kind of say, because we do keep it to 1 hour, our episodes, but it's like, yeah, we're going to let you talk, but you don't know what we have up our sleeve to do next week.
Yeah. People get really attached to their ideas. Like, they listen to somebody like Graham Hancock. I've read one of his books. I've listened to him on Joe Rogan. Seems it's cool. The only reason, like, I don't get emotionally involved is because it's like, it's something that I can't prove and that doesn't really affect my life one way or the other. Like, really cool if we find out there's some giants that lived in the past and they built these cities. Like, that's cool. Doesn't really affect me. So I have like no skin in the game. So it's funny that people get that upset about it.
Well, let me share this with you, because this is one of Flint's biggest sticking points. And actually, we're doing an interview with Flint's ally. So we're kind of breaking with tradition to go against the grain. We're going with the grain in this kind, but we're actually going to double down on some of Flint's what I would call politicization of this topic, because we're interviewing another professor and doctor named John Hoops. And he has been the one that has really claimed the pseudo archaeology and the calls that Graham Hancock make to say Atlantis was this ancient city, ancient civilization. And they distributed their people throughout the world. And then they found these hunter gatherers and gave them high technology. They gave them the secrets. Graham Hancock, in his 95 book, writes that these are white men with beards that descend on the indigenous and save their lives, essentially. And Flint and this other gentleman, Hoops, they tell us that, well, that's actually pushing white supremacy. This is pushing that white savior complex, in that, oh, well, the Spanish conquistadors certainly wrote that history in the late 1700s or late 1600s when they came into Central America. Yeah, they did. They certainly thought they were saving themselves and teaching them new technology. And listen, in many cases, they were. But to say that now, oh, the Mayan temples and the Olmec heads, you know, though they resemble the white people only because the white people came and saved them. It's like, no, you guys are taking away the culture and the history of those indigenous. Mm-hmm. Now, again, I'm not an archaeologist. So their argument would be, because of this erosion of archaeology, it leads to this erosion of science more broadly. And it is kind of interesting when you look at left versus right. You've got the right wing, who are the ones that are questioning the election. You've got the right wings that are questioning vaccines and medicine. You've got the right wing who are talking about, if you go on Ashton's page, right, he's also pushing a lot of right wing politics in addition to these spinning orb videos. And the question would be, why is there this tie over between Republican politics and what is being now coined as pseudoscience? And that is why I liked this topic. And I still don't fully agree. In fact, Artie, can I use this opportunity to issue a public statement to somebody Please. Regarding that interview?
Yeah.
So one of the people that's in this archaeology sphere is named Dan Richards, and his page is Dan Dedunking. I'm messing it up, but it's Dedunking, like debunking. So he has been one of the allies of Graham, and he was actually mentioned in the Graham Hancock interview that was more recent, where they called Flint a liar. And Dan Dedunking is one of the people who had come out and very publicly said, Flint is lying. Here are the reasons he's lying. And some of them have validity. But of course, Flint says those were honest mistakes, and so be it. So in my podcast, when I interviewed Flint was talking about cancel culture and how he's been targeted by the quote unquote pseudo archaeologists to say they're calling my work. And some of these people that are leading this charge, whose channels are promoted by Graham Hancock, are literally outright calling for people to call up my college that I work for and to ask to get me fired. That was what Flint said. And my impression when I was doing the interview was, and editing the interview before I even posted it, was that that was Dan Richards' comment. And I even verified it by looking at Flint's profile, looking at what he's written. He has put that exact statement into writing before. So I thought I was validated when I edited the video. I didn't edit his words, but I added Dan DeDunking's face as he was referencing someone was saying these things. So Flint tried to keep it ambiguous, and I kind of made it not ambiguous. So this statement here, I was actually named by name with that clip by Dan Richards on his YouTube channel just last week. And he said, Elevator Charlie, or whatever your name is, you know, you're rude and you probably were just goading me for clicks, but what you did was a lie. And Flint lied, and I never said that. It was somebody else, and you put my face there. So this statement, and I appreciate you giving me the forum here. This is the first time I'm on camera since I saw that. You know, Dan, I apologize to you, man. I did not know that, and I will do better to do the fact-checking next time or just leave the face out when it was intended to be faceless. I do think that in the video where you had with Mark Young, which is the actual person that called for Flint's firing, I do think you acted a little bit questionable. You were calling for other doctors, who I already mentioned in this show, Hoops, to be fired in that same show. And that video was promoted to your page, which is why in the end I decided I'm going to leave it up, and I think it's fair. Because the video was on Dan's page, and that was said on Dan's page. So in my opinion, Flint didn't name anybody. I put that in there. It was not in cahoots with Flint. And Dan, if that was offensive to you, I apologize. That's not my intent. My intention was to just add more context for the viewer. So I did want to get that out, and thank you, Artie, for giving me the platform, because it is interesting to kind of inject yourself into these roles or inject yourself into these dramas that are in the middle of out playing out. And I had lacked information there, I guess, you know, and it was a 4-hour conversation that I hadn't listened to the full thing where that claim was made. But I thought I was okay. And you do have to remember there's a person on the other side. So that was my little message to Dan. But that's the only thing I have to say about the Flint interview at this time.
When it comes to your podcast and your friendship with Mike, you guys have very different perspectives to some degree. How do you guys maintain your friendship, especially when you're being, everyone has somewhat of an ego, right? Like, you guys are in a podcast, you guys are sparring at times, like disagreeing, and you know, you can state your opinion very boldly, and you guys aren't going to agree. So how do you guys maintain civility in those conversations and outside of the podcast? Or has there been, you don't have to talk about it if there has.
No, there hasn't.
Has anything like leaked out after the podcast where it's like, oh, you guys kind of were like a little bitter for a minute, or, you know, it just didn't sit well or anything?
We are honestly, and I'm not saying this because he probably listens, like, I would tell you if we were at odds, and we truly have not, truly not. In fact, it's made our friendship better. We have, he lives in Miami, I live in Connecticut. So we are definitely significant distance apart, but we talk every day. We text every day. We talk about our topics a lot. In fact, there are many times where we'll be on a phone call for 40 minutes while I'm driving home from work or something. And it's like, what did we just do? We should have recorded this. You know, we're arguing about a policy just by ourselves. Why did we do that? Yeah. You know, but it's just a testament to that. I firmly believe that people in this world are cut out to have those discussions. And there are some people that are not. Yeah. And it comes, I don't want to say it comes down to the self-confidence, because I think that that is part of it. You have to be confident enough to share your opinion and solid enough in your reasonings for holding that opinion if you want to go on a camera and share it. But I think in the case of Mike and I, we're definitely more curious and more willing to learn than we are with our ego, than we are set or married to our way of life. If something came out tomorrow that said, oh, wait, Ray Epps is a Fed, like, I would totally change my mind tomorrow. Or if they said, you know, whatever it might be, you know, Donald Trump really did. Like, how about this as an example to show you how pragmatic I can be? I had a very big moment of panic when Jack Smith released his second indictment, because he rewrote it and it was bad. So he put out the first one, and this is when Trump kind of said, oh, all acts of a president are immune, and the Supreme Court agreed. So Jack Smith meticulously went through and basically identified, hey, you kicked out all of your White House lawyers from the room. You hired your own lawyers. You insisted that they were the only ones here. And then you sent X, Y, and Z emails admitting you knew you were lying while you acted on a personal capacity. Like, Trump, this false elector scheme is a big problem, dude. And I read that document and I was like, my God, it's terrible. This is the nail in the coffin here. Yeah. And actually, I still believe that. I don't know what's going to happen. I think, but it opened my eyes is my point, right? To say, oh, I didn't know that Trump was like kicking out the White House lawyers while he's talking about constitutional interpretation. Or I didn't know that he was telling Mike Pence, stop being so honest in email. Mm. Like, you're going to write that in an email? Even I know not to write that in an email,
yeah,
you know, at work. So it's stuff like that where I'm like, oh my God. So things can happen where we change our minds. But really what it is between Mike and I is the free flow of information and ideas. And when it comes to stuff like foreign policy, when it comes to stuff like border control, when it comes to stuff like inflation, you know, we agree. If you go talk to your neighbor, whoever's listening to this right now, go across the street, knock on their door and ask them what they feel. You are going to be able to, if you're able to have the conversation, find things to agree on. In fact, as you go to more and more topics, there's going to be even more that you agree on, even yeah. the hard ones, even the hard ones.
Yeah.
So no, we haven't had much drama. Mike is a new father as well. So we like to share that stuff as well. But he's one of those ones that I say is on limits. And so am I. If you want to talk about politics with me, please. I love it. I will stay calm. I will be respectful. I would love to have a conversation, but I will certainly call you out when I think you're wrong. And Mike is the same way. You just have to have that mentality. Yeah. Really do. Not to get too personal if anyone's listening, but like Mike and I are in a larger group chat with a couple other people as well. And they are far more vocal about some of their far right and far left beliefs. In fact, we've curated our group chat to now have both sides as well. But it gets heated, and I see myself going after Mike's teammates and, you know, for lack of a better term, right? And I see the right wing extreme guys in my group going after Mike, and they get heated. It mm-hmm. does. But also at the end of the day, it's always like, there's always a message when you sense that it's like, hey, all love, by the way. And it's like, why'd you say that? Of course we know, you know? So it really is, but I guess you have to have that rapport with the person.
Yeah.
Can't go guns blazing to a protester on the abortion clinic and yeah. try to explain your point of view, you know? So
well, it's also a matter of not taking things personally. I think like if somebody yeah. challenges my ideas, I think people tend to take their ideas and take them to heart. But like with my ideas, if I believe something and it's supposed to be grounded in reality and you can ground your argument in reality and argue against it and get me to reconsider, I don't take that personally. I think you've done me a favor. If you give me information that undermines my beliefs politically or whatever, I don't even care if it's politically or not, but I think you've done me a favor. And I get in trouble with that because like throughout my whole life, I'm like, that's the way I take it. So that's the way people should take it when I give them my thoughts.
Yeah, yeah.
Doesn't always work.
No, you just
got to
go back a little slower on the backswing, right? Yeah. And then they chop it into the woods.
Yeah, yeah. Do you ever feel... So first of all, have you guys shifted since working together, since working on the podcast? Have your perspectives shifted toward each other's at all?
Yeah, I would say mine definitely have. And I think Mike probably would say the same in that we originally, I never would have thought that a typical average Democrat could find places to agree with a typical average Republican. Mm. And I think that's what we're told is you have this monolith that you subscribe to. And even if I like 9 out of 10 policies by Trump, but I think, he should ditch the abortion thing. You know, that's even in this case he did, but you know, that would be a deal breaker. People would say, oh, I'm blocking this guy. He's a shill, or he doesn't know what he's saying, or he's secretly working for the Democrats. It's like kind of ridiculous. Yeah. So I'm blanking a little bit on exactly what your question was, but
if you guys, you know, if you guys have shifted.
Yes, exactly. So yeah, I mean, I've totally loosened my constraints and I believe you would too. You know, where I would have yelled at you that the election was stolen, I would now explain to you that it's a very difficult conversation. And I honestly, that's probably one conversation that I shy away from now. I was very excited in 2021, 2022 to explain to you what happened in Pennsylvania, Georgia, Michigan, Wisconsin, Nevada, Arizona. And now I don't want to, honestly. I don't even want to talk about it because I feel that it takes away from my credibility on other things. So that's one of the biggest shifts because that's where I got my start. That's what I was very interested in on Twitter to start. I wrote massive threads that got millions of views, thousands of followers about election interference. And now I'm not interested in election fraud or election interference. I'm just an election integrity enthusiast. That's what I call myself.
Yeah. I mean, 2020 is an interesting thing. I think there's still some questions to be asked. I mean, you have the vote discrepancies that we have now with Kamala. She'll probably end up around 72 to 74 million votes overall.
Yeah.
Trump, I think, is going to end up around 76 million, give or take a million probably.
Yep.
So that means Trump might have gained 2 to 3 million votes and Kamala lost at least 8 from where Biden was. So like that leaves a discrepancy of 5 million total, roughly, that we're decreasing.
Less, though.
Usually we increase a little bit each election cycle, usually because we have a growing population still. It is a little bit weird. And I know you said you don't want to talk about this too.
No, I do want to talk about it though. With you.
But it is interesting because I remember watching the election in 2020 and I was more favorable to Trump in 2020 than Biden. But I remember watching Biden's. Obviously, we had COVID and all that stuff. But you see Biden's rallies. There's nobody there. There's 13 people there separated with 10 feet in between all of them. And then he won with more votes than any candidate in history, including Obama, who was the most popular Democrat leading up to him. And it's like, how did this happen? So that was just kind of hard to believe, hard to accept. And then you get to this one, and I see Kamala's rallies. I'm like, oh, she's looking like a formidable opponent. Like, this is going to be tough for Trump to win. Because most people, there's nobody in the country, basically. I'm surprised when I hear there's undecided voters because it's like everyone knows who Trump is.
I mean, agree with that. Yeah.
Like these aren't new faces. Kamala's kind of a new face for a lot of people. But like I didn't see Trump gaining a ton of ground. I didn't expect him to get 10 million more votes, and we didn't see him get 10 million more votes. But if we're working off of Biden's 2020 numbers, if you add anything on top of that, Trump is probably going to lose. Now we see the vote totals coming in and it's just not adding up. And my sense of like enthusiasm, people seemed way more enthusiastic about Kamala than they did about Joe. Joe Biden, the argument was, well, people weren't voting for Joe Biden. They were voting against Trump. It's like Trump was the opponent in this election too. So why did that hold up in 2020? Why wasn't it the case now? It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, I think that you've said it all correctly. And I think that the way that you've outlined it is the way that almost every Republican voter feels. Now, with that said, just because I am devil's advocate embodied, you know, sure, we changed the way that voting happened in 2020. And that's for why we saw such a huge spike in votes, right? We mail-in balloting happened across probably an extra third of the states that never saw it before.
Yeah.
And in those states, it was like universal. So does that mean that there was fraud? Yeah. Well, maybe that's where that comment would lead me to think that, right? Oh, well, if we're going to send a ballot to everyone, does that mean everyone's just voting? Or does that mean that there was some scheme? And that's one question. You know, you also mentioned rallies. I think back to Hillary Clinton having a rally in the milk aisle at Costco and not one single person showed up, but you know, she still came pretty darn close. In fact, I think she won the popular vote in 16. So I don't love using rallies as a metric because Trump is insanely good at that. And I don't think a Democrat person would maybe even want to go to a rally. You know, they're more sit at home and drink a tea with a blanket rather than get out there with your bros and start screaming. Right now, I was with you though. When I saw the Kamala rallies popping off, I was like, oh my goodness. And then I was even telling people on the right, I was like, guys, stop making fun of her doing accents or whatever, because you don't get it. Like that's charisma. That's actually helping her in that rally. You could hear the audience pop when she's doing these, I'm not going to do it, but right, the pastor accent or the Georgia Fulton County Atlanta accent, like, you know, she's going into those characters in those audiences, and she's actually, I believe, I really did, gaining support. Now, the argument back was, no data supported that. She kept shrinking in the polls, and I guess that's true too. But that would be my rebuttal to anyone who says, oh, well, look at these rallies. I just don't think it's really a good judge. And then when we talk about the decrease in votes this year, I would have estimated that there was a pretty steep decrease this year as compared to 2020, because you came into 2016, which was, let's just call it, the last, you know, election cycle before a media frenzy. And then from 2016 to 2020 under Trump, you had this media frenzy of hate Trump, hate Trump, hate Trump. And then it actually continued because they had to deflect from anything the Biden administration was doing. It continued as hate Trump, hate Trump. So while I see a lot of these Biden voters saying, yeah, it's not really a vote for Biden, it's just a vote against Trump, I think that those are the demographic that stayed against Trump, and they had no problem switching to Kamala. But I think that you actually, well, I think both ways. You lost and you gained a lot when she came on, because a lot of people think, oh, she already lost the primary. We don't have faith in her. We never got to vote for her. I'm just going to sit the whole election out. And I could see that happening with 2% of people, you know, which is about what 5 million is, maybe 3%. But then the other side of that is, oh, well, it's not Joe anymore. It's actually someone who's younger. It's actually someone who's, you know, not 80, right? I think she's 60, 61 or something like that. But she, so maybe she did turn out more votes that way, but it's very difficult. And I think the main data point that you got to take away from this one is Trump gained in almost every single demographic, virtually every demographic. The only ones he did not were college educated women and 65 year olds plus. So, okay. Republicans have to figure out how to appeal to those demographics or just forget about them altogether. They did a great job appealing to Hispanics and blacks, like, obscenely well. Yeah. And hopefully that can keep coming. But I think the Democrats learned a very valuable lesson here to anti-Trump isn't a platform anymore. Yeah. And it is going to be a platform for 4 more years, though. I mean, do you think we're going to see this media frenzy over the next 4 years of calling out Trump hatred every single day? Or are we going to maybe see Anderson Cooper and Jake Tapper moderate themselves and say, you know what, Trump did a good thing today?
I don't know. It's interesting with the popular vote going Trump's way this time. Because that was something that kind of, it kind of just sat in the air after his first win. It's like, yeah, he won the Electoral College, but he won the popular vote, which is kind of a stupid argument. It's like saying, oh, my team lost the Super Bowl, but they got more interceptions. So they kind of won in a certain way, you know? It's like, or more running yards, that'd be a better, you know? It doesn't make sense for an argument for, you know, like it doesn't undermine the win at all, but in their heads, I think it did. So with Trump getting the popular vote too significantly, like it's not like close. I think if they're looking at this as a business, which they are, they have to be, it's like, okay, do you keep trying to cater to this shrinking segment of the population that wants to hang on this narrative? Or do you start like leveling it out and appealing to that bigger crowd over here, maybe start winning some conservatives back? And I think CNN, it seems like they're trying to be better over the last few years. Like they, you know, they fired the one guy. I wasn't sure if they would. I don't watch
Stelter,
CNN.
I think you're talking about, or Lemon.
Well, they fired the head of CNN in.
Zucker.
Yeah. So they fired him. They got another guy in his place. I wasn't sure if that would just be for show. I think some of it was for show, but I do think that they're trying to at least be a little bit more level-headed.
Yeah, I think you're right. Well, hey, they got to stay afloat somehow, and I think they know that airports and doctors' lobbies are turning them off.
Yeah.
And so they probably see that their last constituency is changing the channel. So that's, so to speak, or quite literally in this case. But it's not good. It's not a good state of affairs. But as they're saying on X now, we are the media now. I don't know that I believe that. I think there's a lot of regurgitation that goes on. I think you still definitely need investigative reporters. And I don't think that putting investigative reporter in your bio makes you that. you know, because you do see that a lot, or citizen journalist, I guess. I really think there's a lot of digging that has to go on. And actually, I never claimed to be a journalist or anything. In fact, I stopped writing articles because I'm not that. And I don't do the due diligence. I parrot other things, and that's not productive. So I stopped. But I think that in when you're really trying to do justice and do a piece of writing that's meant to inform people or meant to change minds or meant to expose something, you do an injustice if you don't cover both sides. Yeah. If you don't say, here at least is what the other side would respond to this, then you are not writing a good article, frankly. And you do see that. You do see that one sentence, whether or not it agrees with the headline or totally disrespects the rest or disregards the rest of the article, you do see that in USA Today. You see that in Wall Street Journal. You see that in, you know, maybe not Politico, but you see it on CNN. And I guess you see it on Fox, but you don't see it on Gateway Pundit. You don't see it on The Federalist so much. You don't see it on OAN. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't see it on MSNBC, I don't think. But you have to have the other side, or else I'm going to immediately say, you just twisted this.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a good way to make yourself seem more fair, I guess.
Yeah. Do you see, well, first of all, I have one more question about with you and Mike. So you are the right-leaning guy. Mike is the left-leaning guy. You're the Republican. He's the Democrat. Do you feel like the labels box you in ever? Like, do you? Internally, do you feel like that creates an expectation of you to have a certain viewpoint that long term, like we have there's something called the consistency principle. I've wondered about this. I just read Influence by Robert Cialdini, and I've often wondered about this, like Tucker Carlson, other commentators. They get up, they start talking, and they share their point. They tell you what's the truth and what's not. And we have a tendency, we want to be consistent with what we've said before, with what we've claimed we are before. Have you run into that, or is it a concern for you pitting yourself as this and Mike is this other thing, and you guys have to live up to those labels that you've created or that you've...
It is actually a great, great, great question, because as you're asking me the question, I'm thinking, no, we really try to be as authentic as possible. But I feel that way that you've described as a representative of the party to say, you know, I have a really great example, actually. Another interview that we did that was really, really cool. It was actually our first bigger name. It was probably episode 18, 19, 20 or something. And it was Michael Morell, the former deputy director of the CIA. And he also served as the daily presidential briefer to George W. Bush when 9/11 happened. And that's like a crazy guy to interview. And we were so excited because Mike, it was right around 9/11. It was the end of August. Mike is a big 9/11. I don't want to say the word fan because that sounds really terrible, but he's like very interested in 9/11 lore. So we did this little series of three or four episodes where we talked about how Taliban was raised, how the attacks actually were planned and who was involved and how it happened. So anyway, we got Michael Morell, who was like the guy to talk to about this on the show. So we talked about 9/11, and he's a former CIA guy. So we did show notes and all of that. We talked about what we wanted to talk about, what he didn't want to talk about. He said he didn't want to talk about torture techniques or enhanced interrogation. He says he talked about it a lot on other podcasts, and it's not productive to a 9/11 conversation. So we said, you know what? We agree. We won't bring it up. It's part of the story, but it's something we can talk about on our other episodes or the conclusion, and we just won't bring it up with Mike. No problem. So we had a great conversation with him. We even asked great questions like, what are your thoughts when people say the CIA is the deep state or the spin of the media and that kind of stuff? And he gave really cool answers, you know, obviously towing the party line of the CIA, but being rational and normal and cool. So when we published the episode, it got a really outsized response, and we were really excited because he's a high profile guest. But the truth was, I got personally a little bit of hatred on my page as the right-wing guy, because I don't know if you'd know this by the name Mike Morell. I didn't know the name. I'd never heard of him before until we secured him for the show. And it turns out that he was actually the guy that penned the letter, the 51 intelligence agents that wrote that.
I didn't
Hunter's
know that.
Laptop is hallmarks of Russian disinformation. He penned the letter, and he sent the messages to all the other folks saying, we want you to sign this. Would you? And they all said, yeah, Mike, I will. And so everyone goes, how did you interview this guy for over an hour and didn't even ask him about that letter? I was honestly pissed at myself, but I was shocked. I didn't even know he did. Yeah. You know, had I Googled his name a couple times more, I probably would have known that. So that's a great example, though, where I probably should have been the representative for my party, and I decided or just was naive not to. But there are also times where we talk about immigration or we talk about abortion is a great example, because I'm just not on the side of Republicans on that, you know, where I do try to ask the questions. At least I said before, I'm devil's advocate embodied. The truth is I will. And I also use the word debate pervert. That was another live streamer. Who's the liberal guy who talks about Gaza and Palestine? Hassan. Hassanabi. That's his name. He coined the term debate pervert because it's like, you just want to get in the arena. You don't even care what side. You just want to get in the arena and start debating. So I kind of adopted that as well. But it does. The one thing that we have to do, Artie, is not destroy our own credibility. If I can ask a question, I can say Republicans say that, right? Or Republicans think this en masse. But I could also say that I don't personally. That's okay. It's allowed, you know? Mm. So that's kind of what I do. But we think that if... we always have to inject our own opinions because that is how we keep it authentic. But then at the same time, I've often said we when talking about Republicans and Trump, and I've stopped that. I've kind of now said conservatives or Republicans, and I actually treat those two titles differently as well, which is another conversation. But, you know, they feel this way, not necessarily we do. So that's kind of how I approach that.
Yeah, I try not to label myself too much. Like people can call me a libertarian. I mean, I resonate with some libertarian stuff, but
look, I'm drinking from a Taylor Swift cup.
Do you have any cats?
No cats. One dog.
But yeah, I try to avoid the labels for that reason. I just think that it creates more in our head than we realize, I think. When it comes to Democrats, I think, or the left, whatever you want to say, do you think there's a future for them? I know that there is, like there literally is a future for them. But what do you think that future is? Do you think they're going to be, are they going to have an identity crisis over the coming years? Like lately, we've just seen a lot of blame. Like we haven't seen any accountability in the Democratic Party. It's like, it's whoever. I mean, they've blamed everybody but Kamala Harris at this point, and the Democrat establishment. Do you think that they're going to revitalize and be relevant going forward? Because I'm hoping so. I think we need both sides. Otherwise, whatever side's remaining becomes totalitarian.
I think that's exactly what I would think. What's coming into my head is, oh, that third party option. And actually, this is probably a hot take. I don't think that's the option. I don't think that's the right way. It's just not realistic. In fact, I was talking about that bell curve before where you're probably somewhere in the middle. I'm probably a little bit more farther to the right, but not extremist. And the center keeps shifting. So it's actually pushing you to now be, it's not pushing you left. It's pushing society left or the ideals left. But you as a person are still staying equally distributed. So what I think is on this two-party system, what will happen is eventually it will swing back. I mean, we've been talking about abortion as kind of like the hot button of people are very divided, even in the Republican side. And I think that if we were to go down this route over the next 4 years where a Republican-aligned House, Senate, and executive all go down this kind of very, very extreme route, they will lose people. And I think that's going to then shift things where now all of a sudden things are shifting to the right, because of our legislation and because of what the people in government are putting forward. But at the same time, now you're now pushing the distribution is going to be more people on the left. Mm. So, you know, hey, Democrats were the party of the KKK and slavery and the ones about the against the Civil War. And that's obviously changed, right? Where now the Republicans are the ones that are regularly labeled racists and bigots, however low credibility that may have. But it swings. So, yeah, there is a place for the Democratic Party. And I'll give them the credit to say they are not the ones. I was going to say they're not the ones that are overrun by conspiracies, but they also are. So I'm not going to say that. But I do think that they have more basis in black and white printed fact. Can I say that? Is that, do you get what I'm saying when I say that? In that, if you were to go argue with them about Russia, I think that a conservative or Republican hardcore would say, that's totally fake. There's not one element of truth. Look at the Durham report. No collusion, no obstruction. But then a Democrat might say, like, well, hold on a minute. Look at Manafort. Look at Flynn. Look at Bannon. Look at all these different things. You know, there is verifiable instances of this. Now it comes down to your interpretation of how impactful that was. But I will put my hands up as a Republican and say, I do think that they have a better handle on just logical, cold, hard statistics. And that's while they can get better at being less empathetic, less emotional as well, and maybe more grounded in a populist message, I think Republicans need to get more grounded in hard facts and data, less anecdotal evidence, like my uncle died of a blood clot from a stroke from a vaccine. You know, that is, I don't know if that's a productive conversation to be having. So that's the credit that I give those guys.
Yeah. Hey, there's a book called How to Lie with Statistics. I think everyone should read. Actually, Bill, what's the name? The vaccine guy, Bill Gates.
Okay.
He recommended it. And I don't like him as a person, but I'm like, I want to read what he's saying. Recommend that book. And it's, you know, there is funny ways that people can put their evidence out that even though, like, it might be true, the conclusion that they arrive to with that true data might not be infallible, you know?
Yeah. No, I get it. And listen, it's true though, right? So everything I just said, because Manafort talked about voter demographics and Mike Flynn forgot and didn't mention that he had some contact with a Russian when he wasn't an elected official. I mean, those are the exact specifics of what happened. So does that mean that the Trump campaign colluded with Russia to win an election?
No.
Like, I guess we would argue no, but they would argue yes. So it does come down to, though, the interpretation of the statistics. So
yeah.
It's interesting Bill Gates would push that, because I'm sure a lot of people are going to be angry at me saying, yeah, but look at these statistics, or look at, they're doing it just as bad. And
sure.
I agree. I do.
Well, I mean, you can take reasonable data and turn it into a conspiracy theory. I mean, like, flat earth conspiracy theory. It's like one of the most, I'm open to conspiracy theories in general, but flat earth is just, it's a stupid conspiracy theory. but like, you can take all these little things that did happen, like Donald Trump Jr. and somebody had a meeting. They were told it was about adoptions or something like that, and then it ended up being an actual Russian meeting. You can take all these little things and see them for what they are, but you can also take you can see a lot of conspiracy theorists out there who are like, Trump's elected, he's in Putin's pocket. Like, that's what they believe. And it's like, there's really no evidence for that. Like, he had sanctions on Russia. There'd be no reason for him to have been, you know, basically very assertive with Russia had he been pro-Russia. You know, it's just,
it doesn't make sense.
He just sees Russia as an autonomous country and respects their autonomy. I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. We might not like Russia, but there's a lot of leaders out there that we shouldn't like, but we can't really do much about them because we've seen what happens when we try to insert ourselves into other countries. And yeah, we create more chaos. We create Al Qaeda. We create terrorists. You know, that's what happens.
Really quick, actually, we talked about that, how the conspiracy is that the CIA funded Osama bin Laden. And actually, we broke that down in our episode where it was that the CIA did. They funded Osama bin Laden while he was a fighter for the Mujahideen.
Mm-hmm.
But then he defected from them, who were allied forces, and then created a terrorist organization. So it's, well, he didn't exactly fund freaking terrorism.
Yeah.
It's a crazy world out there. What was the first thing you said before I brought up the terrorism?
That we have conspiracy theorists that go from reasonable data to conspiracies.
It's It's scary. No, I was going to talk about another episode that I just recently did. Oh, yeah. The Russians. So we recently interviewed a Russian scholar named Sergei Radchenko. And he spent a decade, no exaggeration, 10 years going between the Kremlin and Beijing to read these unsealed archives of data that go all the way back to Stalin after World War II. And he was able to read like the personal journals of Khrushchev, and he would listen to recorded rants of Brezhnev. And it was now he's able to write this book that was called To Run the World. And it's literally 950 pages, but it was really cool because it showed more of, I don't want to say a Russian perspective, but it showed the thinking of the Russian leaders. Whereas the history that we've kind of learned about, specifically the Cold War is what period this covered, but it was that the Russians are these crazies and they have no rationality and they're just dictators and we need to stop them, you know? And as you read these kind of like even quotes from transcripts, it's very interesting that it, and it was my reading that, and I think our guest and the professor who wrote the book kind of agreed with me, but not fully, was I almost started to empathize with the Russians. And it was like, hey guys, we're a major country. You guys are imperialists and so is the West. But we just want a fair shake at things. Like, can you please respect us? And we were like, eh, no, you know. And so that's probably the least judicious possible reading I could give the United States. But because it was written by this Russian scholar and showing their real emotion, it was like, no, these guys were shitting bricks that we were going to have a nuclear war. And they didn't want that, you know, even though they perceive themselves as really tough. So why do I say that? It's because we've been told that the Russians are this boogeyman. And sure, they have human rights violations, I'm sure, and they have this illegal infiltration to Ukraine. But at the same time, it's like Trump is at least acting diplomatic in saying, let's have a conversation and figure out what's needed. Biden and Harris, I think that Harris even admitted in one of the debates, they haven't even talked to Putin. Yeah. They haven't talked to him in 4 years. That's like really insane. That's definitely not how to end a war. I'll tell you that.
What's the name of the book?
To Run the World.
To Run the World.
Kremlin's Bid. I have it over there, but I don't have it pointing me. Okay. It's by Sergei Radchenko, To Run the World.
Awesome. Yeah, I love books that give you a perspective that you're just not. I read a book called Soldat. I don't know how you pronounce it, but it was written by a German soldier. I think he got to be a general in the Nazi army. And it's like, not a perspective you'd think you'd be like, oh, I want to hear this. But at the same time, we think of like, we create this image in our head of like, there's a bunch of Nazis and they're all horrible people. And it's like, not all of them were actual like diehard Nazis, party line people. A lot of them are just people who got, they were just Germans who had to go to war because they were part of Germany. So it's really interesting hearing those different perspectives of like, oh, yeah, the U.S. did some things and are a little sketchy, and you know, like we're not in war. I mean, I'm like this with war. I appreciate war as a real thing. It's just going to happen. But at the same time, like it's an ugly thing. Like war, you can consider yourself the good guys, but the good guys do bad things during war too, because it's war and war is just ugly. So
I'm reading a new book now called Nuclear War, a Scenario, or it's by Annie Jacobson. I'm probably butchering the title.
I listened to her on Sean Ryan's show. On
her, oh, okay. I saw her on Rogan maybe a year or two ago, but I just had availability in my book roster here to pick one up. Yeah. And it was very interesting that these bombs that we dropped, the atomic bombs, killed, I'm probably going to mess up the number, but I think it was like 80,000 people immediately, immediately upon bursting. Now, the nuclear weapons that they developed just 3 years after that, in like 1948, they could take out the entire half of the globe with one bomb. Did you know that the thermonuclear hydrogen bombs that we have now, they're the size of a freaking aircraft carrier? They are massive. These things are tens of thousands of tons. And they could, I think it was something like in the ramp up of nuclear weapons that we created was we had like 2, and then we had like 8, and then we had like 30, and then we had 100, 400, 2000, all year after year after year. And it was like, wait a minute, eight of these end human populations. 8 of them, the whole world. So what are we doing with thousands and thousands of them?
Yeah.
But it's, hey, that's how it happens. But what I was getting at was Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, it was both in this book, they both toyed with inviting Russia into NATO at that time. They both toyed with it. I mean, Russia really wanted it under Putin. And it never ended up happening. And then in 2016, there was this whole crossfire hurricane, and Russia was again made this big boogeyman. So it was really, you know, you can't help but think, is there some sort of narrative going on? But they're obviously bad as well. I'm not going to not say that. So are the Nazis.
Yeah. Well, Cooper, it's been awesome talking to you, man. We should do it again sometime. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, Artie.
I love to ask people about books that they read. You just mentioned one or two, actually. But what are some books that have influenced you in your life? They can be political or not, whatever. Just like hearing what people like reading.
So I'll tell you, I'll admit, I've not been the biggest book reader since after college. And Mike and this podcast have gotten me back into it. Hmm. And since then, I'm looking at the stack. There are like 13 books there. Here's the two that I really would like. And the first one I'll recommend was an author that we also interviewed named Patrick K. O'Donnell. And the book I would recommend would be Washington's Immortals. Hmm. We actually interviewed him about a book that he wrote called The Unvanquished. And it talked about the Confederate Secret Service and the undercover operations that the Union soldiers would do. So it was actually like the first time in the Civil War that soldiers would wear the other side's uniform and do clandestine operations. And actually our entire special operators group and everything into World War II, they didn't exist. And then they went back and studied this group from the Civil War, Mosby's Rangers, and that's the Confederate side. I'm forgetting the Jesse Scouts on the Union side. They studied these two battalions and how they infiltrated the camp. And then they used this information to create the office of whatever our initial special operators was called in World War II.
So that
was cool. But before that, this guy wrote a book called Washington's Immortals, and it was about the Revolutionary War. And it covered this elite fighting force out of Maryland, the Marylanders. And they had like two or three guys that ran it and lasted the entire Revolutionary War right by George Washington's side. And they became known as, like, if we need some sort of special insurgency done, or if we need some kind of like the bravest of the brave men to go right in the front, we need to call the Marylanders. And they were coined the Immortals because they would lose 80% of their men, and then they would go with their own money, their own manpower. They'd go back to Maryland. They'd recruit more soldiers, and they'd get right back out there at Washington's specific, his own request to say, you're my guys. Like, we need you, please.
Yeah.
So it was really crazy to listen. I it was one of my first books that I've read really about the Revolutionary War. I'd read a few on the Civil War, so that one was cool. But this one on the Revolution, I had no clue what I was getting into. So those are both by Patrick K. O'Donnell. Hmm. And then the other one that I want to suggest would be Lessons in Liberty by Jeremy S. Adams. And he was our guest just last week on our podcast, so it's still our most recent. But we had interviewed him previously about his book, Lessons in Liberty. And this is a cool book if you're a centrist or moderate, because it actually shows the character flaws of some of our great leaders. So he goes and explains how George Washington or Abraham Lincoln or Teddy Roosevelt all had these own personal problems where maybe they were really had a short temper like Washington, or I think Lincoln had these I forget exactly what the issues were at this point, but then he also goes into the other side, right? He goes into, I think, Clara Barton and Daniel Inouye, who is this Hawaiian senator. And the stories, though, all come back to say, these are great people, but these are the examples why you have to remind yourself that people are flawed. And they're both all people that kind of were able to find common ground, reach across the aisle. And I feel that it really embodies the message that our podcast was. So that's why we both kind of picked up the book randomly, said, Jeremy, please come on. And he's now been a recurring guest on our show. So how could I not recommend his book? It was a good one to read, Lessons in Liberty.
Awesome. Thanks for the suggestions. Before we wrap up, please tell listeners where they can find your podcast, where they can find you on X and any other platforms you have, and anything else you feel like sharing.
Yeah, for sure, man. Well, we are on all platforms. Primarily for the podcast is YouTube, Spotify, and X, because those have the video. But if you go to our website, elevatedthoughtspod.com, You'll find all of our links to all of our socials. We do the clips on TikTok and Instagram. And actually, here's what I would say. And then on X as well is my biggest account where I post personally, at Coop Sims, or you'll see at Elevator Charles, because my name's again, Charles Cooper. But one thing I'll leave you with is, if you're running a podcast, you got to be on every app. I live on X. That's my home base. I have friends there that I've never met. You know, I don't even know their real names, and I've been there hours and hours a day. But if you're only building and developing on X, you're missing out. You got to get on the other apps. As much as you may despise them or loathe them, TikTok, for example, has been one of the best drivers to get watchers on our YouTube, because the TikTok clips, they might get 100, 500, they might get 10,000 views, whereas our podcast episodes full don't get nearly that much. Yeah. So you got to work on your funnel, guys, and look at my website, look at my link tree, all the different platforms. I talk a lot about that on my X page as well, because we're in this podcasting network and all of that. So if anyone wants any help too, that's like, I love to give advice and help, but hey, that's what I have.
Awesome. Well, Cooper, it's been awesome. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk with me today. And yeah, man, thank you for the conversation.
Yeah. Thanks, Artie. This was a great time. We'll see you soon.